Was that the same love you showed massacring Native Americans and taking our land?
Hey, I am Native American in me.
Genesis chapter 25, verse 19.
I'm not even gonna deal with that, man.
And these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham begat Isaac. And Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel the Syrian of Padanaram, the sister to Laban the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren.
Jacob, and the Lord entreated of him
and Rebekah's wife.
Get it up, like Joe Clark.
And the children struggled together within her, and she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two men of people shall be separated from thy bowels.
All right, as you can pay attention to this up here, it says two men of people will be separated. Separated.
Well, it's talking about the separation between
Jacob and Esau.
Yeah, so
okay, meaning that Jacob and Esau were meant to be separate from each other.
So
they weren't meant to be together.
Two men of people
shall be separated from thy bowels.
Go ahead.
And the one people shall be stronger than the other people.
The one people shall be stronger than the other people. Read on.
And the elder shall serve the younger.
That means the baby that came out first is going to be a slave to the baby that came out second. Read on.
And thou shalt serve the younger. And when
that's
day,
right. Who's first right now? You white people. Read on.
And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb.
Not identical twins, but fraternal twins, meaning that they came out at the same time, but they looked separate.
They had the same parents.
Okay, they had the same parents.
But they looked different.
Right, read on, but they looked different. That's right,
and
like the elder said.
And the first came out red.
And the first came out red. Look, come on, read.
All over, like a hairy garment. And they called his name Esau.
That's you, my man. Look at you. You're red and hairy. Okay, and I know you probably got it.
Yeah, the breakdown. The breakdown is when the baby came out, he read again.
Yeah.
And the first came out red all over, like in hairy garment.
It didn't say it was hairy.
Yeah.
Okay, it said the first came out red. All over like a red hairy garment.
Like a red hairy garment.
Because what they used to do, they would take the heifers, the red heifers,
yeah,
and they would cut the skin, and then what they would do is they would dye it red. You know what that is, brother?
Almost 30 pounds of heavyweight fury right here. It's a 50 BMG, and this is a 750 grain projectile. And we're fixing to put it to work. All right, this is a big old gun, and I love big old guns. I'm gonna actually do a little bit of deer hunting. That's right, deer hunting. If you're watching this video online, you have any questions or comments, go ahead and post them below. I wanna show you, first off, deer hunters use primarily a 30 caliber cartridge. This is a standard 308. This is a 50 BMG. What we're gonna do, we're gonna load up this Barrett right now. I'm going to shoot this 50 caliber round. I want you to see what kind of recoil that this gun provides the shooter, and I think you're going to be shocked because although it is a big, big round, with the muzzle brake and the weight of this rifle, it really reduces recoil where it's actually manageable. We're going to shoot it, then we're going to head to the stand and see if we can get a deer in front of us. So here we go. And of course, eyes and ears. You only shoot it one time without the ears and you won't have any. I think we're on. Time to head to the deer woods now. If you have any questions or comments about the video, post them below. And yes, this is a 50 BMG.
It's post-rut right now. The deer have slowed down. We're on a management hunt with Keith. We're gonna try to harvest the doe. We gotta take a few does out of here this year. And everything has just slowed down. The rut is about a week over. But we finally got a nice doe to come in, one that we wanted to take off the ranch, and Keith put the knockdown on it.
Well, you look at that. That was pretty fine right there. I like this gun. We're at the Legends Ranch up here and really on a management hunt. I had the opportunity to shoot a BMG, a 50 caliber BMG at the range, and I said, I've got to take it on a hunt. Now, it's shooting a 750 grain projectile, and I headshot this animal. And the one thing that I think you'll look at and kind of be amazed at least I am, is, I mean, take a look. You would have thought it would have done a lot more damage, but the thing is, accuracy is everything, shot placement is everything, but with a 750 grain projectile, I certainly would have thought that would have done a whole lot more damage. Now, one thing I want to tell y'all is that I wound up wanting to do a headshot on this deer, and I want you to watch. You know, we wound up, the perfect doe came in, and it gave me an opportunity, and I rested the gun. I absolutely felt confident in this shot. Now, I want you to just take a look at it, and then I'm going to get right back with you.
Here it goes.
All right, now we can play that shot back slow-mo, and the concussion, the report of that gun is so loud that literally it caused the camera to get all jacked up for a minute. But you can take a good close look. Now, where would you think I hit that deer? Where would you think I hit it? The answer is, after we went down there and we took a look at it, and I mean took a really close look at it, it became very, very clear I didn't hit the deer. We reviewed it back, we skinned the animal's head out, we looked. I completely missed that animal. But the lesson to be learned here is that 50 BMG round has so much pressure, so much vacuum, if you will. When it goes past something, it actually sucked the eyes out of the head of that deer and it killed it instantaneously. A very ethical kill, but I missed the deer. If you have any questions or comments about this video, go ahead and post them below. I would love to hear from you. And I want you to know that I want you to subscribe to our channel, because I'm going to be taking this 50 BMG out and doing a lot more hunting. And hopefully next time I'll actually hit the animal.
His aspirin.
Which aspirin?
We're not doing it again.
I'm doing this for the cover of Time magazine. I love Time magazine. What you will do for a cover, this bird is seriously dangerous but beautiful.
Has science gone too far? Are humans playing God? These are all questions asked when dealing with topics such as creating hybrid animals, cloning, and genetic engineering. While there are benefits to it all, we are entering a world of the unknown and should proceed with caution. In this list, we'll be showing you five of the strangest hybrid animals. We would like to give a big shout out to viewers Safwan Wan, Darren Fennelly, and Max Flame for suggesting this video. Number 5. Growler Bear. While many hybrid animals are man-made as we directly got two species to mate, the growler bear is actually a naturally occurring hybrid. It's a mix of a grizzly bear and a polar bear, which is a very strange mix and kind of sad too. You see, grizzly bears and polar bears don't usually live among each other. However, since the polar bear's natural habitat is being destroyed due to climate change, they are being forced to move further south. This is where they meet the grizzly bear, and as nature has it, they seem to get on well. Maybe too well, as now there's such a thing as growler bears. So while this hybrid is not man-made, it's kind of an indirect result of mankind's actions. Number 4. Jaglion. This hybrid is simply stunning, a perfect blend of two beautiful creatures. If you haven't yet guessed, it's a mix of a male jaguar and a female lion. These two amazing cats are from the Bear Creek Exotic Wildlife Sanctuary in Barrie, Canada. They are sister and brother, and came to be after a jaguar and lioness who were raised together took their relationship to the next level. The sister cat named Jazara inherited her father's melanism gene, giving her the dark pigmentation classic to some jaguars. While only 6% of all jaguars are fully black, with majority having a golden coat and black spots, Jazara got a blend of both. She is fully black but also has the spots, while her brother wasn't so lucky but still looks awesome. Number 3. Kama. This interesting hybrid is created from a male camel and female llama. You may know that a camel is about 6 times the size of a llama, so mating would be pretty impossible. This is why this hybrid was created using artificial insemination in Dubai. The idea and reason for this hybrid was simple. They wanted to make something with the size and strength of a camel, but with the easier temperament and higher wool production of the llama. The result was the Kama. Interestingly, the Kama is also one of the rare few hybrids that are always fertile, and this results from both the camel and llama having the exact same amount of chromosomes. Number 2. Zebroids. A zebroid is the name for any zebra hybrids, usually from a male zebra and a female pony, horse, or donkey. They never occur in nature, and many zebroids can be born with a form of dwarfism and are almost always infertile. They usually take on the build of the female animals, but have the stripes of the zebra. Sometimes the stripes never cover the whole body and just appear on parts like the feet and legs, or even patches over the body. Number 1. Wolf Dog. A wolf dog hybrid is actually quite common compared to the other hybrids on this list. Obviously, this hybrid is a mix of a dog and a wolf. The most common mix is to use a dog breed that already has a physical resemblance with a wolf, such as the German Shepherd. Their appearance can be quite unpredictable, but most of the time they make for much stronger and smarter pets than dogs. However, they aren't as easy to domesticate and can be quite wild. With that being said though, even wolves can make excellent pets with the right conditions and owners, and be just as obedient, loyal, and loving as dogs.
Ten incredible hybrid fruits. Plum quartz, aka pluorts. This, as you may have guessed, is a cross between a plum and an apricot. Like most on this list, this hybrid fruit is the result of a cross-pollination of two plants from the same species or genus. It takes years of selective breeding to produce a hybrid fruit. The plum quart, for example, took a biologist over 20 years of research and experimentation. Candy floss flavored grapes. Yep, grapes have been crossed with candy floss of all things. These very sweet grapes were created in California using absolutely no chemicals, and the seeds for this grape plant come from a test tube. Get ready for the rise of the novelty flavored grape, because flavors like mango, strawberry, gummy bear, and Skittles flavored grapes will soon be on supermarket shelves. A tayberry is a cross between a raspberry and a blackberry. This hybrid fruit was patented in 1979 and it's named after the River Tay in Scotland. A tayberry looks like a raspberry, but it's more elongated and it tastes like a juicier and sweeter version of the normal raspberry. Blood limes. The name of this one isn't as much as a giveaway as to what the hybrid is compared to the rest. Blood limes are a hybrid citrus fruit developed in a project to investigate salt-resistant crops. These are a cross between a red finger lime and an Ellendale mandarin, which is a hybrid in itself. So the blood lime is actually a hybrid of a hybrid. The Tangelo is a tangerine with a pomelo or sometimes with a grapefruit. Tangelos are larger than tangerines, and they don't have the bitterness of a grapefruit. Sometimes referred to as honeybells, they generally have loose skin and they're easier to peel than oranges. The Pineberry. This one is a strawberry mixed with a special type of strawberry. When I say special, I mean it's a strawberry called the beach strawberry, which can only be found in Hawaii and off the Pacific coast of North and South America. This white berry has red seeds and it tastes strangely of pineapple. The Limequat. This is a hybrid cross between a lime and a kumquat. It's actually really small compared to a lime and it's only around the size of an olive. This was crossed to create a citrus fruit that didn't have a harsh, acidy taste, but instead has a soft, sweet tang. A Justaberry is a cross between a blackcurrant and two different types of gooseberry. It looks like a gooseberry, but it has no thorns. It's sweeter and it combines the vigorous growth and rich flavour of a blackcurrant. Peekatums are a peach, apricot and plum hybrid. This fruit feels like a peach but tastes like a fruit punch. It's trademarked by a company called Zega Genetics, which is an organisation that develops crazy fruits through deliberate hybridation. You can only buy this fruit in a nursery in Stanislaus County, and inventor Floyd Zega and his three children have painted in more than 500 new fruits, which they will hopefully soon release. Bubble berries. This fruit is a cross between a strawberry and bubblegum, and I actually really, really want to try one of these. They grow in remote forests in Central Europe, and bubble berries were eaten in the 19th century, but they kind of faded out. The bubble berry is also known as a musk strawberry, and they are known to have an incredibly strong and sweet smell. And that's the end of 10 incredible hybrid fruits. I jolly well hope you liked it, and as always, thanks for watching.
Only speaks to people who've broken one of society's ultimate taboos, the illegal practice of sexual contact with animals, a subject some people may find disturbing.
Oh my gosh! Fire!
Don't shake it, you'll spew it everywhere.
There was never a day in my life when I was growing up and I said, okay, I think I'm gonna go have sex with animals today. It started out when I was very small. I just had a deep connection with animals, all the pets that we had growing up and all. I just felt deep feelings for them, and as I grew older and these feelings matured, it eventually moved on to sex. There was no decision made.
I see animals as spiritual beings first, and because I see them as my spiritual equals, I don't have any issue with seeing that they have the same needs that I have, which is to eat, to enjoy their bodies, and to love and to be loved.
I've been with animals, I've been with humans. I love to be with both.
Five years ago, I made a film about people who choose to have sex with animals. After it was shown, a number of zoophiles, as they like to be known, wanted to tell their stories.
Can't can't go by a group of horses without taking a real close look at them and wondering. Mm-hmm. Great many thoughts.
There's a black one there with a big blaze and several and a couple white socks that just, she's nice.
Oh, hello.
Hello, bud.
Hello, pretty boy.
Sweetie.
Easy, easy. Cool. Please do come visit. Hey, baby. Hello, pretty one.
Hello.
Wow. Now this is a rush. Ah, yes. A piece of ecstasy. This is the most incredible turn-on when I'll approach like this. This is the most incredible turn-on. Ooh. This is a pretty girl here. She's an Arabian.
This is the first time that they've spoken openly about their secret desires.
If they found a field full of horses, it may be a while.
Oh, I know Ken. He scratches the ponies for hours on end.
They wanted to show me a strange and often shocking sexual subculture. I was surprised to find these passions are not limited to lone individuals.
I wish I was as sexy as Amara is sometimes.
They included women, couples, and even animal relationships within families.
That good? You can get it kind of juicy. It'll kinda soak
juicy?
It up if we put it back
okay.
in the fridge.
Okay.
Yeah, and then the questions are, well, you know, is it the same as with a man? Is it as good as with a man?
No, better.
Well, it depends.
Yeah, it depends on the dog, depends on the man.
You know, a lot of human men just aren't as, they don't like foreplay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Dogs love foreplay. They love to have a good time. They love to have sex.
I just thought, should I add some mushrooms to the salad, too?
Yeah, you could probably do add some in the sauce. And
that's
some
what I was going to do.
Recent videos released by the Center for Medical Progress reveal Planned Parenthood's inhumane treatment of unborn children and its executives negotiating the sale of baby hearts, lungs, and livers.
Another boy.
How did we get to this point? To understand present-day Planned Parenthood, we should understand Margaret Sanger, Planned Parenthood's founder and hero.
Margaret Sanger was a big proponent of negative eugenics, which was the viewpoint that you should weed out unfit people from the bloodline. So that would be encouraging people not to procreate if they were unfit, feeble-minded, had any kind of mental illness, and that also included forced sterilization.
Words like unfit and feeble-minded were used to describe not only the poor and mentally ill, but also to describe African Americans.
Margaret Sanger stated that birth control is nothing more or less than the facilitation of the process of weeding out the unfit, of preventing the birth of defectives or of those who will become defectives.
In 1921, Margaret Sanger founded the American Birth Control League. Its primary mission was to prevent uncontrolled procreation and establish a world program of birth control.
She states, "Knowledge of birth control is essentially moral. Its general, though prudent practice, must lead to a higher individuality and ultimately to a cleaner race." Margaret Sanger stated that the most merciful thing that the large family does to one of its infant members is to kill it.
In 1939, Sanger wrote a letter to her eugenics colleague, Dr. Clarence Gamble, a member of the Birth Control Federation of America, in regards to setting up the Negro Project, a birth control clinic for African Americans.
She was speaking about serving what she called the Negro population. And in concluding this portion of the letter, she stated that we do not want word to go out that we want to exterminate the Negro population. And the minister is the man who can straighten out that idea if it ever occurs to any of their more rebellious members.
Sanger believed that having an African-American minister on staff would ease the suspicion.
African-American populations were considered some of these unfit members that should be weeded out. So in this letter, she discusses having African Americans serve other African Americans so they wouldn't be aware that they were seeking to terminate them, to exterminate them by the use of birth control and negative eugenics.
Singer was quite fond of Dr. Ernst Rudin's work, director for the Society for Racial Hygiene. He would later go on to write Nazi Germany's sterilization laws. In 1933, she published his article, Eugenic Sterilization, An Urgent Need, which promoted programs to eliminate the unfit in order to create a super race. In the late 1930s and 40s, knowledge of Nazi atrocities made words like eugenics and population control unpopular in America. So in 1942, to distance itself in name, Margaret Sanger's American Birth Control League became Planned Parenthood. They weren't just being established in the U.S. It was global. A grim fact in American history was the forced sterilization of women in Puerto Rico. In 1936, sterilization programs spearheaded by the International Planned Parenthood Federation, with funding from the U.S. government, sterilized one-third of Puerto Rican women by 1968, making it the highest proportion of childbearing-aged persons sterilized in the world. And today,
Planned Parenthood facilities are generally located in low-income areas, which are heavily populated with minorities. And a lot of times they seek to reach those minorities to help them with reproductive rights, they say, with birth control and largely abortion.
Independent studies have concluded that nearly 80% of Planned Parenthood facilities are set up in minority communities. It's no wonder abortion is the leading cause of death among African Americans, higher than all other causes combined. Mounting evidence against Planned Parenthood's beginning to today continues to fuel public outcry.
The American people should seek to immediately defund Planned Parenthood so that our own tax dollars don't go to support this organization who has been exposed to be lying to the American people for many years, for committing these egregious acts against the youngest children among us. They should be immediately defunded.
Did I not work all week? 5 days a week, right? So where the fuck is my money going? Time going on when?
You didn't work last Thursday.
When do time go in? Time go in on Wednesday. And I did work last Thursday. I worked all week last week. Why the fuck you don't write our hours down? You see how you playing with my money talking about you didn't work last Thursday? Kobe, did I not work all week last week? I work every fucking day. Every single fucking day. Now why the fuck is you playing with me, bro? You think, bro, like, come outside, bro, because that's how I'm feeling right now. Because you think this shit a game, bro. If you want a knuckle, we can go in the fucking rain. Bro, my check is 27, bro, and I worked all week last week. Explain to me why my money is fucking short. Can you do that?
Yeah, I can.
How?
What time do you get the fucking
Stop
work?
Stop fucking asking.
I'm not fucking. I'm serious.
Bro, so what's up, bro? You want a buck?
What
you want
time
a buck?
For work?
Do you want a buck? Because we can fucking buck. What's poppin'? We can buck, nigga. You playing with my fucking money.
Get out of my face.
Ain't no fucking get out of your face. Stop playing with my bread, bro.
Get out of my face.
And what?
Get out of my
and
face.
What?
Get out of my face.
And what?
Get out of my face.
What you gonna do about my bread? Huh? Explain my money. What you gonna do about my money?
What time did you get to work on my
What Every the day. Fuck?
What time did you start work?
Bruh. Because I really...
I'm being dead serious.
What time did you start work? How do you calculate how much money I make then, since you want to worry about what time I start work?
What time do you fucking start work?
Bro, back up out my face. You spitting in my face, bro. Stop playing with me. Stop playing with me.
Time you get to work, the time you're done, and the amount of work you get done.
How do you know what time I get off and come to work? How?
I know what time he gets here. Cause I'm still here when he
gets here. You know what time he get here. How do you know what time I start working?
Cause I know it takes him
to answer my fucking question. How do you know what time I start working? Are you there?
No, I'm not.
So how the fuck do you know? How do you know what time I get off work?
I know he's
gonna. How do you know what time I get off work? How do you know what time I get off work? I wanna hear this shit. How?
I know
so how the fuck you gonna calculate my money then? How you gonna calculate my money and you don't know what fucking time I get off work?
Easy.
How?
I'm here after he gets back. Turn your fucking phone off!
Man, you better handle what you're what's in front of you.
Your business. Don't worry about this. Cause you playing with my bread, bro. You really playing with my money, bro. You really gonna make me see about you, bro. If my motherfucking check ain't reimbursed next week, we have a problem. I know you can't fix it now, so I ain't gonna get on your fucking ass. But you playing with my bread, bro. You think it's a game. You think I won't go on your shit. You really think I won't go on your shit? I don't give a fuck about this job. Because literally you've been playing with me for the last fucking 3 weeks. Now, if you feel like you boss up and you want to jump out your seat, there's plenty of fucking space outside. Plenty. Stop playing with my fucking bread, bro.
I'm here today to bring my bill from Mr. Mitch McConnell to show him. If you're not familiar, I'm on a second chance program. I have to have my rent in on time. I have no more money coming in. I am a guard at the Smithsonian Institute, and I need my rent paid, and I have nothing. And I need to know, when is he going to open things back up? Because I'm about to be evicted. If I don't have my rent in by the first of next month, through the second chance program, I will be evicted.
He's not in the Russell Building, he's not in the floor of the Senate, and 800,000 people don't have their paychecks. So where's Mitch?
Our children also are affected and
We have a shutdown, and so they can't go to work, and so then they have the vacation, but they don't have to use their vacation days. And then they come back, and then they get their back pay, then they're in some sense, they're better off.
Our bills. I can't provide for myself. I don't know where my next meal coming from. I'm bored. What I supposed to do? They just dropped the ball on us, sent us out on Christmas vacation. We haven't been back to work. And they're trying to put us back to work with no pay. That's not fair. And I blame the president.
Can't pay the bills. More medication. I'm worried about better pay for the medication that I have to pay for. Gas to get there, to get the medication, to try to get it. My rent, my kids in college, I can't even, you know, tuition, they need help. Water, gas, lights, I mean, it's impacting me pretty bad.
I have a little 10-year-old daughter that is my pride and joy. She's my heart. I actually had to take her out of cheerleading because I didn't have the money to pay for her to continue it. It's hard. It is. It's as a man personally, and my daughter being my pride and joy. Me and Enmeats, like, we don't make a lot, like everybody think. Like, oh, you know, you're supposed to have 3 to 6 month savings. But that's hard when you're not making that much to have 3 to 6 month savings and you have bills and you got to figure out if you want to pay your car payment, if you want to pay your rent, or your life insurance. You have to basically pick options. It's been very hard.
You know what most Americans know, that if you don't get paid, you don't pay your bills. You can't, how are you gonna pay for childcare? What if you have a prescription that you have to fill? Mm-hmm. What if you need to figure out how to pay your rent, but you didn't get that check? It doesn't work, life doesn't work.
What consequences could I face if I don't pay alimony? If the court orders you to pay alimony and you refuse to pay, some or all of these enforcement efforts could be taken against you. Contempt of court. If you refuse to pay court-ordered alimony and you have the ability to do so, the judge may find you in contempt of court. The punishment could be a fine or a short term in jail or both. Alternatively, the judge may order you to stay in jail until you actually pay. Wage withholding. The court may order your employer to deduct your alimony from your wages before they are paid to you. Seizure of property. Your delinquent alimony may be taken from your bank accounts or from money owed to you like rents, dividends, and royalties. Other types of property that you own may be seized and sold to pay delinquent alimony. Liens on property. Liens may be placed on your property. Before you can sell the property, you will need to pay the alimony to clear the lien, or the sale proceeds will be applied towards your alimony. Tax refund intercept. If you also have past due child support, your federal tax refund can be intercepted and applied to your delinquent support and alimony. When you can't pay. If you fall behind on your alimony because your income has declined or your expenses have increased, don't wait until enforcement action has begun against you. Take steps to have your alimony payments suspended, reduced, or terminated. You can try to get your former spouse to agree to a temporary or permanent reduction or termination of your alimony. If you and your former spouse reach an agreement, be sure to put the agreement in writing and have it signed by the judge. If you and your former spouse cannot agree, you can ask the court to modify or terminate your alimony obligations. You may be able to get a temporary reduction or abatement if you have been laid off. If you have to take a salary cut, you may be able to get your alimony permanently reduced or eliminated.
Check out these pictures from my European vacation. We did Venice, Paris, and Rome. It was incredible.
Wow, I don't get it. We have the same position at work, and I could never afford to do anything like this. Didn't you go to Australia last year?
Oh, yeah. That was fantastic as well.
A new car in the driveway, too. What'd you do, rob a bank?
No, I won a lottery.
Oh, you're kidding, right?
Remember, I got divorced last year.
I see. You got a very good settlement.
I got a great settlement. But even better, I got an alimony award.
Alimony? But your kids are grown. How did you manage to get alimony?
Alimony has nothing to do with child support. It's money to keep me in the lifestyle that I was accustomed to when I was married to Eric.
I didn't know you could still get alimony if you didn't need it.
With the lawyer and the way laws are written, you'd be surprised at what you can get. Did you ever wonder why I didn't get that promotion last year?
Well, yeah, it was a done deal. That didn't make sense at all.
I withdrew my name from consideration. And advice from my lawyer. He said that if my income were any higher than it is now, I might not get as much alimony. So I thought about it and decided, I don't want to work that hard. I mean, why should I? Besides, I deserve alimony. Do you know how much he has to pay me every month?
I didn't know Eric could even afford to pay you that much every month.
I hear he is struggling. The business went under and he has health issues now. That's his problem.
You know, Bob and I have been married for many, many years, and the spark died a long time ago. This would be a great way for me to start over again. I could do all the things I wanted to do without Bob's agreement. I was always worried about our retirement, paying the bills, putting the kids through college. We never have fun anymore. What's the name of your lawyer?
Alimony is wrong. Today, there are more than 500,000 people across the country held in bondage to support another capable adult indefinitely after their marriage has ended. This scene plays out every day throughout our country, and it destroys lives. Involuntary servitude was outlawed by the 13th Amendment to the United States Constitution in 1865, and yet state courts across the country routinely impose this endless fabricated obligation to provide private welfare upon thousands of victims every day. An alimony order is harmful to both parties in different ways by its very nature. It keeps wounds open. People who seek divorce want to end their relationship to the other party and move on with their lives. An alimony order does not permit this to happen. When one is ordered to pay alimony to another, they lose rights that the state has no constitutional authority to take away from them. An alimony payer cannot pursue employment of their own choosing if it means they will earn less money. They cannot voluntarily retire. They cannot go bankrupt. They have been stripped of their right to pursue life, liberty, and happiness.
A lot of breaking news here this morning. The breaking story just moments ago, the Supreme Court and this landmark ruling, the court making same-sex legal, same-sex marriage legal in this country across every state in this nation. Going into today, 37 states in Washington, D.C., 13 states illegal, but those 37 states had same-sex marriage, and now that will change in all 50 states. I want to get back to John Carl at the White House because, John, 2 days in a row, yesterday, the Supreme Court, for the second time, handing the president a victory. And as we just learned, the president has tweeted he would consider this a victory at the court as well for his policy.
Absolutely. Two major victories for the president at the Supreme Court, and both of them coming courtesy of justices appointed by Republican presidents. In this case, Justice Anthony Kennedy was the majority on this, was that critical fifth vote joining the liberals. Justice Anthony Kennedy appointed to the court by Ronald Reagan. And yesterday, the majority decision in that Obamacare case was Justice John Roberts appointed Chief Justice and to the court by President George W. Bush. These were two decisions that the world has been watching, but have been watched no more closely than here at the White House, and both coming down exactly as the White House wanted them to.
John, stick with us here. I want to get right over to Terry Moran, who covers the Supreme Court for us. And Terry, I wanted to get your reaction to a piece of audio during the arguments in this case from Chief Justice John Roberts. Let's let everyone at home listen to a little bit of that argument. I can tell you what he said in the court as we prepare to get that audio, but Justice Roberts telling the court, I mean, if Sue loves Joe and Tom loves Joe, Sue can marry him and Tom can't, and the Chief Justice asking, why isn't that a straightforward question of sexual discrimination? And ultimately for him, that was the question, Terry.
That question where he essentially said, if two people love the same person, the opposite sex person can marry that that person, but the same sex person can't. And there was a glimmer of hope among the advocates for same-sex marriage under the law that Chief Justice Roberts might find his own path through gender discrimination, that it's merely a matter of gender that distinguishes one side from the other there, that he might come over and vote for constitutionality of same-sex marriage. He did not, but very characteristically, he offered not an angry dissent necessarily, but a more gentle one. This is his last paragraph in his dissent. He says, if you're among the many Americans of whatever sexual orientation who favor expanding same-sex marriage, by all means, celebrate today's decision, he says. Celebrate the achievement of a desired goal. Celebrate the opportunity for the expansion of your commitment. But do not celebrate the Constitution, he says. It had nothing to do with it.
All right, Terry Moran at the court, 2 days in a row, two very historic decisions. We appreciate your reporting.
4 times I have told you not to call me sir.
For many transgender Canadians, interactions like this one are just the tip of the iceberg. Despite existing human rights protections in many provinces, some say they still face discrimination and even violence. Today, Justin Trudeau says he's hoping to change that.
I'm proud to announce that tomorrow, on the International Day Against Homophobia and Transphobia, we will be tabling a bill in the House of Commons to ensure the full protection of transgender people.
Trudeau didn't give any details about the bill, but it's expected to amend the criminal code to spell out that it is a hate crime to attack someone for their gender identity. It will also include transgender people in Canada's Human Rights Act, evening out disparities from province to province.
It saves our community from having to fight time and time again through courts and to get legal degrees to try and fight our way through to rights that we already have had.
The bill is expected to protect both gender identity and gender expression. That nuance is important, some say, because people often face discrimination based solely on how they look. For instance, when they try to board a plane.
A trans person that wouldn't look female or male enough according to the paper that they have would then be refused boarding in Canada.
But discrimination, she says, goes beyond that, from housing to employment to simply finding a bathroom. That's been the big debate in U.S. states like North Carolina. But even here in Canada, some politicians have argued that allowing trans people to use the bathroom of their choice would give cover to sexual predators. Not true, says NDP MP Randall Garrison.
The washroom stuff is a completely false issue that's used to generate fear on this issue.
3 times Garrison has proposed similar trans rights bills. Twice they passed the House but died in the conservative-dominated Senate. Conservative MPs were divided on the issue last time around, but at least one says he's had a change of heart.
But I think things are changing. I think people are changing. Certainly I am, and I recognize my constituents, and so I'll be voting in for it.
We don't know what the official line from the Conservative caucus will be. A spokesperson for leader Rona Ambrose says they have to wait until they actually see the bill tomorrow.
That was different. We thought you were inferior.
Now you know better. Cornelius was right, Doctor. He proved it. Man was here first.
You owe him your science, your culture, whatever civilization you've got.
Then answer me this. If man was superior, why didn't he survive?
wiped out by a plague, some natural catastrophe, a storm of meteors. From the looks of some parts of this planet, I'd say that was a fair bet.
But we can't be sure.
He is. He knew all the time, long before you found your cave. He knew. Defender of the faith, guardian of the terrible secret. That's it, isn't it, Doctor?
What I know of man was written long ago, set down by the greatest ape of all, our lawgiver. Cornelius, come here. Reach into my pocket. Read to him the 29th scroll, 6th verse.
Beware the beast man, for he is the devil's pawn. Alone among God's primates, he kills for sport, or lust, or greed. Yea, he will murder his brother to possess his brother's land. Let him not breed in great numbers, for he will make a desert of his home and yours. Shun him. Drive him back into his jungle lair, for he is the harbinger of death.
I found nothing in the cave to alter that conception of man, and I still live by its injunction.
Lasers sound like the stuff of science fiction, right? Sound completely unbelievable. How could our military possibly be using those in future warfare? Guess what? We've just had a recent breakthrough, more great test results that are making lasers a reality. So it's called Athena. Lockheed Martin makes it, and they've been doing a lot of the pioneering in this laser field. Now, what's really exciting about it is that it's so hard to harness that much power and make it compact enough that it's actually going to make practical sense downrange. And they've proven that they can do that. Recently, they tested it against 5 moving drones, so realistic drones that they might go up against with, enemy forces might send against us, for example, or terrorists might send against us. And it successfully shot down all 5 of the drones. This is huge news because it means that in a realistic, practical setting, it's looking very promising, so it could be ready to field quite soon. So when you see the movies, or you look at comic books or television shows, when you see laser weapons, they tend to be a color, right? Red or green or something like that. Real lasers, one of the key advantages that they provide is that they are invisible. You actually can't see them. You just see this damage suddenly starting to blow something up. So if we take a look now at what the Athena did to a truck. So we're looking at a truck engine, and the Athena within seconds was able to beam right in there, heat the whole thing up, and burn through the engine of this vehicle. So if you can imagine if you were in that vehicle, all of a sudden, this hole would start appearing in your engine, and the whole thing would just disappear. That's what these lasers do. Now, there's some other key advantages that we should mention. Let me give you 3 of them. 1, unlimited ammo. As long as we have power, we have an unlimited magazine. And downrange, of course, having unlimited ammo can be a huge advantage. 2, it's silent. We don't give the enemy any advance warning that it's coming. And then the 3rd one I wanted to touch on is that it travels at the speed of light. So not only are we delivering powerful, 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 decisive effects, lethality, we're also doing it so rapidly they don't know what hit them. So if you could circle back to that example of being in the car again, that would happen so instantaneously, within seconds, you truly would have no idea what was happening. It would just suddenly start disintegrating, right? So what can we use these against? So we talked about the vehicle a bit. We talked about how Athena has just proven itself against drones. But in the real world application, our forces could use it against the drones. We could use it against aircraft. We could use it against vehicles on the ground, like we mentioned. We could also use it against fast attack boats. And in fact, Athena's sibling, Adam, a couple years ago proved that it could eliminate these fast attack boats. So if you imagine, boats start trying to swarm one of our ships, not a problem for this laser. Burns right through the hull. As you can see right there, it's burning right through the hull. I'm incredibly excited about this news, this great news about the successful testing of Athena, because it means that we'll be putting these powerful weapons soon. We could put them in the hands of our warfighters and give them even more powerful weaponry to keep themselves safe and also to deliver the effects that we need. They can be used, laser weapons can be used offensively and of course defensively too to help protect our homeland. Think of our airports that might be under threat from enemy drones. They could be used to protect our, we could use them statically and used to protect our airports. They could be used to protect our power grid, our nuclear plants. So there's lots of different exciting applications for this technology. It is no longer science fiction, but science fact.
Getting hot. Come on, people, go. Go. Oh, come on, what are you waiting for? Go, 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 go. Oh my God. I better put the camera down. It's okay, Ling Ling, it's okay.
That fucking, the guardrail's on fire even. Look at that.
Oh my God.
Keep going, buddy. I don't want to be a looky-loo.
Okay, get over. Because there's nobody on the side.
This is Clark Road. I just passed the bowling alley. Here's the golf course coming up right here.
Hey, what's up, guys? Jake the Asshole here. As many of you know, I live in the state of California where these quote-unquote wildfires are taking place. I don't live in Southern California. However, even where I live in Northern California, in Modesto, I am seeing the aftermath of these fires. We have smoke filling our skies. The sun is partially obscured by smoke and debris. So we're seeing the effects, even in Northern California, from the fires that are raging down south. Now, when I look at the drone footage from Malibu, California, it immediately raised my eyebrow, and it should raise your eyebrow as well, because this fire seems to be the most selective fire in the history of all fires. I have never seen a fire select and choose certain houses to burn down to the ground the way this fire picks and chooses. This fire will burn a house completely to the ground and leave all the trees in the front yard and the backyard completely untouched. This fire will pick and choose one house in the middle of two houses and burn one down to the ground, meanwhile leaving the house on the left and the right completely untouched. Why, take a look at this image. The house on the left, untouched. The house on the right, untouched. The trees in the front yard and the backyard, untouched. However, the house directly in the middle, scorched to the ground. So somehow this fire chose to scorch the entire house to the ground while leaving all the trees around the house in the front yard and the backyard completely untouched, and the house to the left and the right completely untouched. Like I said, this fire picks and chooses which house it wants to scorch. And it doesn't just halfway scorch a house. Oh no. If it wants to take your house, it will burn every inch of your house to the ground. Meanwhile, the lucky neighbors just a few feet away, well, they just happen to luck out and their house is completely fine. Does this seem natural to you folks? That one house scorches completely to the ground. There's nothing left. And then the neighbor's house is completely fine. And all of the trees are still standing around the house. We're seeing this more and more whenever these quote-unquote wildfires pop up. So is this a new characteristic of wildfires? We must ask ourselves, what's really going on here? Now, some speculate these are direct energy weapon attacks. And by the looks of it, I can't argue that. In my opinion, this does look quite a bit like some sort of direct energy weapon attack. So the question becomes, why? Why would the government or somebody be shooting direct energy weapons at these houses? Well,
now I want to tell you about the story that we mentioned at the very top of the hour about this new fire danger. You're going to find this fascinating. First of all, I want to tell you about the very worst nuclear meltdown in U.S. history. No, by the way, it was not. It was not Three Mile Island. See, everybody thinks that because that's the one that got all the hype and the media attention and the movies and the television shows, right? Three Mile Island. Actually, the worst nuclear meltdown took place in 1959, and it happened right on the border with Ventura and Los Angeles counties. This place where this happened, it's now a Superfund site. So designated as kind of a, what's a Superfund site? Well, it's kind of like a no man's land where the federal government comes in and says, this area is so infested with nuclear material, we just want to keep people out of here. So why is this information interesting? Well, this place that I was just describing, this place between Ventura and Los Angeles County, it's called the Santa Susana Field Lab. It was the site of several nuclear accidents where nuclear material was released into the atmosphere back then. In fact, by the time the leaks were finally sealed, when they finally were able to control the mess, 459 times more radiation was leaked than the 1979 meltdown that you hear so much about at Three Mile Island. Okay, now, why is this important now? Why am I telling you about this now? Here's why. See that picture? Because some of the almost 3,000 acres that encompasses that site, contaminated with those toxic materials that I just told you about, which is one of the worst in the world at the time, that's where the California fire is partly now burning. That's part of what's being burned by this California fire that we've been telling you about this week. And more than 500,000 people live within 10 miles of this place. All right, California environmental officials say there's nothing to worry about, even though we're looking at this picture and you can see that red area was where the fire was, right? But scientists and Physicians for Social Responsibility in Los Angeles, that's an organization that's speaking out about this, including doctors, they're saying the toxic materials are in the soil and in the vegetation, and when it's burning because of these fires, it's becoming airborne in smoke and in ash. They say tonight that there is a real possibility of heightened exposure for some of the area residents. This is just the latest development in what is now being called one of the worst wildfires we've seen in California history. Hey, let's do this. Let's stay with this nuclear theme now. We're joined by Mr. Paul D'Arienzo. He's in New York City. He's an investigative journalist, and he's been looking into these situations that we've been talking about in California. I want to start with this fascinating development that I was just sharing with our viewers here at RT America about this Santa Susana Field Laboratory site. 2.8 acres that, frankly, I had never heard of. And the idea that there was a Superfund site there, the idea that there's so much toxic material there, and now the new idea that there's a fire that's burning some of that material sounds precarious. How worried should we be, Paul?
Pretty much worried. I mean, but in a way, the fact that that you didn't know about it till now shows that the people who set it up did their job well, because it was supposed to be classified from the very beginning when it began in the 1940s, and they did a lot of classified work there, mostly on rocket engines for everything from NASA to nuclear missiles. And there was a portion of the area that was dedicated to nuclear work. And in those areas, they built 10 experimental reactors. Four of those reactors that we know of failed, had major accidents. The most major was the sodium-cooled reactor, which had a tremendous accident, which is we know very little about, besides the fact it was a tremendous accident that gave off more radiation than Three Mile Island did. And other than that, very little is known. It's a highly classified site, and whatever we learn about it, we learn in dribs and drabs over a long period of
time. Well, I'll tell you what we're learning about it now. We're learning that most of the area that you just described, where all these horrible things happened, where 459 times more radioactive waste was deposited than what we saw at Three Mile Island, that place that you just described is now on fire. So I'm not an expert, and I'm just thinking to myself, if you take something where there is so much toxicity and you light a match to it, I can't help but imagine that those million people who live within 10 miles of there should know, should be may be affected. What's being done to let those people know that they could possibly be in danger?
What can you do? What can you do, really? Ultimately, I would say that every person who lives near a site like that should own a Geiger counter, and their own Geiger counter, and should also, there's websites and different places you can go to that do independent research. And in fact, that's what the activists in that community and in the community by San Onofre both have been demanding, an independent review.
Well, these guys with the environmental group there in California, I forgot the name of the organization, not the scientists and the doctors, but the government side, they're saying there's nothing to worry about. They've checked it. Everything everything is okay. Why shouldn't we believe
him? Well, they always say that.
Well, why shouldn't we believe?
No, you shouldn't.
Why?
You can't.
Why?
Because this class, a lot of the things that happened, at least on the at Santa Susana, were classified, and therefore they're things that are not just never going to tell you, and only accidentally does it come out. As far as San Onofre, the big problem there is where the waste goes, and that's a problem with all the nuclear plants, and it's double problem when you have a plant that's been decommissioned like San Onofre. Where do you put the actual parts of the plant when you knock it down? It's not like a house where you knock it down and put it in a hole in the ground. You have to put that stuff somewhere where it's safe, and you're not even allowed really to keep it anywhere. Under the present laws of the United States, you must keep radioactive waste from a nuclear reactor on the site of the nuclear reactor. And they have two ways of storing it. One is in a liquid pool of water, and the other are in special casks, dry casks, and made by the Holtec Corporation. And there's many problems with both. With the dry cask, what happens if the water boils, with the wet cask, the wet method in the pool water, what happens when the water boils away, or if there's a crack or an earthquake puts a hole in the side of the pool and the water runs out? Then the reactive material and waste becomes hotter and hotter and hotter and is very, very dangerous.
Paul.
What happens if... Yes.
I'm just so sorry. We're out of time. I'm going to let you go. But you know what? It's a good interview. I really appreciate you sharing your perspective on this. And there's reason tonight, at least as far as we're concerned in California, to be concerned with that situation. We thank you, sir, for your time.
Thank you.
Hey, YouTube. Thanks for checking out our channel. We hope you enjoyed the video. We have tons of content for you just like this. For more of RT America's one-of-a-kind news and analysis, be sure to subscribe.
Hundreds of birds have fallen from the sky in The Hague, the Netherlands, during a 5G experiment to see how large the range was and whether the new wireless technology would cause any harm in the local area. News of the adverse effects suffered by the starlings was slow to break, as initially the birds died in small numbers during the first wave of experiments. However, when a further 150 birds suddenly died at the same time, falling into a public park, people began to take notice and investigate. What caused the death of 297 birds in a park in The Hague? Now, if you look around the park, you might have seen what is on the corner of the roof across the street from where they died, a new 5G mast, where they had done a test at almost the exact same time as the birds fell from the sky. Now, according to reports, nearby ducks seemed to react oddly as well. They, at the same time, put their heads underwater to escape the radiation, while others flew away, landing on the street or in the canal. Now, this information that I'm giving you now comes from a local's Facebook page in that area. In the meantime, back on October 30th, 2018, we received some more information. The birds that fell massively dead would be the victims of an experiment performed on those days in The Hague, where RF radiation was tested with a peak frequency of 7.40 gigahertz. This information comes from one source and should still be confirmed if possible. They go on to say it is not clear at this moment whether tests from 5G transmission masts have been carried out again, but so far everything points in the direction of 5G as the most probable cause. Now, the Dutch Food and Consumer Product Safety Authority, or the NVWA, is having a number of birds examined in the laboratory. Parts of the park are blocked and dogs are no longer allowed to be let out. The dead birds are always cleaned up as quickly as possible. Yet it is a crazy scene. Councilmember Robert Baker of the Party for the Animals had the feeling of being on a crime scene. The fact that so many birds fall from the sky at this location must have a cause and must be investigated. Now, there's a link to this information below this video. Go take a look at it for yourselves. The truth about the safety of 5G is that it's not safe, and corporations are being allowed to roll out the new technology before they are sure about its effects on humans. The rollout of 5G technology is a massive health experiment that will have disastrous consequences for the human race, according to the first major university study into the controversial wireless service. In a coalition of 200 leading scientists and doctors are calling for an urgent stop to the rollout. 5G technology is a very real danger, warns Dr. Moskowitz, a public health professor at the University of California. The development of 5G, or fifth generation cellular technology, constitutes a massive experiment on the health of all species, he said. With the death of the birds in the Netherlands, we are already starting to see the results of 5G technology. What do you think? Could this new 5G technology be deadly to humans or cause some sort of physical damage to humans? Leave your comments below this video. Thanks for watching.
A new government project aimed at protecting the nation's food supply is raising eyebrows. While it could be major advancements in agriculture, a group of scientists say the project could be easily turned into a new type of weapon. Alex Mihailovich has the full story.
From machine guns to atomic bombs, the human obsession to find better ways of killing each other has led to increasingly lethal options through time. Some say the next big thing in death, however, will be a silent killer, but could be just as devastating as the biggest of bombs when used against targeted populations. The weapons? Genetically modified viruses. One group that is hard at work developing genetically modified viruses is the U.S. government's Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, or DARPA. The DARPA program, which is under scrutiny, is called Insect Allies. Established in 2016, the four-year program has a budget of $45 million. The U.S. military says the program was created to ensure food security. Basically, if faced with natural or man-made threats, Insect Allies would come to the rescue by sending out bugs to help crops. For example, insects could be armed with genetically modified viruses that would be inserted into crops by the bugs, making the crops drought-resistant. However, critics say the research can easily be used for nefarious purposes. Aside from the obvious problems of controlling insects once they're released into the environment, these bugs can be used to destroy crops or even spread deadly viruses amongst human populations. A group of independent scientists and lawyers recently objected to the research. In the journal Science, they said, "The program may be widely perceived as an effort to develop biological agents for hostile purposes and their means of delivery, which, if true, would constitute a breach of the Biological Weapons Convention." Just last year, Russian President Vladimir Putin expressed his concerns over a genetically engineered virus that could kill humans. While chairing a meeting of Russia's Human Rights Council, President Putin said, "Do you know that biological material is being collected all over the country from different ethnic groups and people living in different geographical regions of the Russian Federation? The question is, why is this being done? It's being done purposefully and professionally. We are a kind of object of great interest." According to DARPA, the research is still in its early stages and the goals are to help people, not harm them. Insect Allies program manager Blake Beckstein told the Washington Post, "I don't think that the public needs to be worried. I don't think that the international community needs to be worried." Meanwhile, many scientists and other experts are worried that if this program ever goes beyond the lab, it could be disastrous for ecosystems and possibly the human race. For RT, I'm Alex Mihailovich.
Now we go back to the list and the second item on our list, which is number two. We told you about this at the beginning. We're calling this the hidden spill. There's a reason we call it the hidden spill. An oil spill that has been quietly leaking millions of barrels of oil into the Gulf of Mexico, and it's gone unplugged for so long that it now verges on becoming one of the worst offshore disasters in U.S. history. You heard it right. One of the worst disasters in U.S. history. You've heard of the Deepwater Horizon and the Exxon Valdez oil spills, right? Well, this oil spill that I'm referring to right now, you've probably never heard of. It's called the Taylor Energy spill. And you know when it happened? It happened back in 2004. This Taylor Energy spill is largely unknown outside of Louisiana, mostly because of the company's effort to keep it a secret, in the hopes of protecting its reputation and its proprietary information. As it turns out, this Taylor Energy spill has been quietly and gradually leaking oil off the coast of Louisiana for 14 years now. And now, according to several sources in the Washington Post, it threatens to overtake the Deepwater Horizon spill as the biggest offshore disaster in U.S. history. Some estimates are put at the spill rate at 10,000 to 30,000 gallons of oil per day in the Gulf of Mexico. Can you imagine that happening for 14 years and most people didn't even know it was going on? Joining me now is an RT producer who's been working on this story. I got to tell you, as I look at this, joining us, by the way, is Siya Tavanger. I had no idea when I saw this report. I was startled. How were they able to keep this under wraps for so long?
Well, Rick, believe it or not, the oil and gas industry is extremely underregulated. Now, to give you a little bit of background, the Gulf of Mexico accounts for 20% of the U.S. oil and gas production, and it's extremely rich in oil, and which is the main one of the main sources that U.S. drills in. And now within that business, it comes a price, and that's oil spilling. Now, usually annually, there's 330,000 gallons of oil being spilled inside the Gulf. Now, in 2004, when this happened, when this spill occurred at Taylor Energy, they actually did report it to the Coast Guard. But what happened was they reported that they're only leaking about 5 gallons per day.
So they lied.
They lied, exactly. Yeah. And as you said, it's leaking about 10 to 30,000 gallons a day of
oil. So that's a lot of damage.
That's a lot of damage. So you do the math. Since 2004, we are at 153,000 gallons of oil that's being spilled. And to give you a comparison, BP, the BP disaster was at 176 million. So it's about to surpass the BP disaster.
Let's look at those numbers one more time. So BP spilled how much?
176 million gallons of oil into the Gulf of Mexico.
And they paid, as I recall, into the billions, right?
They paid $66 billion in fines and damages.
Because it was very public. Everybody
exactly.
knew about it. It was in the news.
It was a slap in your face kind of disaster that everybody heard.
$66 billion. Keep that number in mind, everybody. And then these guys who put just as much oil into the Gulf have paid how much?
They have paid, well, they've put aside a fund, a trust, for $666 million. Now, this is where it gets really interesting.
Uh-huh.
Now, there are Taylor Energy, which no longer exists.
Uh-huh.
So, kind of the only person that remains at Taylor Energy is suing the Interior Department for what remains in the trust, which is $450 million.
That's it?
That's it, which means...
So, hold on. They're going to end up possibly paying $400 million for the same amount of damage that BP did, and BP paid, you said, $66 billion.
Billion with a B.
$66 billion over here,
exactly.
$400 million over here.
And you know what the problem is? Because in 2008, Taylor Energy sold off all their oil and gas exploration to a South Korean company. Now, since then, the South Korean company has sold off the little lots. So now here's a company that no longer exists, and here's a platform that's sunk 500 feet deep into the water that's leaking about 30,000 gallons of oil per day, and nobody is being held responsible because nobody knows who to pay for it.
I imagine, though, this is amazing, by the way, the fact that you're saying there's really... By my estimate, as a non-expert, it looks like they're not really paying enough money to be able to provide the cleanup. Not
right.
at all, right?
They're paying
not if we go by the standards established
Absolutely
by BP.
Not. No, they're paying. It, I mean, it's a dime in the bucket if you think about it.
Wow. Okay, let me ask you this as well. I imagine the people who live there along the coast in Louisiana, good people, hearty people, great food, by the way. Some of the best food anywhere in the world, Cajun food. They live off of this industry. It provides them jobs. I mean, the oil industry is important for Louisiana. Are they conflicted?
Well, they're extremely conflicted because the BP disaster actually killed off the whole beach tourism industry. Even though the BP oil spill never even affected a lot of the beaches, a lot of people heard about it.
Mm-hmm.
So it killed off tourism. And what will surprise you is that it was the citizens of the area that actually demanded an investigation. So hadn't it been actually for the citizens living around that area, we wouldn't even be talking about this story right now because nobody would know about it.
Really know the details of this. Great reporting, Siya.
Thank you very
much. Good job. This is important information that people need to know about.
Absolutely.
We appreciate it. All right.
The U.S. is running out of bombs, and it's probably because we drop one every 12 minutes. Technically, there's no war. America is not officially at war with a single nation, and yet we are waging war in 76 countries around the world. That's insane. That's almost 40% of the countries on this planet. The Pentagon plans to invest $20 billion in munitions alone, and it's not even sure the industry can make that many bombs. They cannot keep up. At a time when the number of bombing runs exceeds the number of bombs, and the numbers just keep growing. George W. Bush, who started the war on terror, dropped 70,000 bombs in 5 countries. Obama dropped 100,000 bombs in 7 countries. Trump dropped 44,000 in his first year. 120 a day. One every 12 minutes. And we cannot even get upset about it, let alone do anything about it, because most of us don't even know it. The media is preoccupied with other things, like making sure we all know how much Democrats and Republicans dramatically differ, and that liberals and conservatives hate each other, when really they totally agree on the big stuff, like bombs. Recently, a $716 billion defense bill breezed through Congress. The vote was 85 to 10 in the Senate. That's enough to overcome any veto by Trump, which would never happen because, well, every 12 minutes. This massive legislation is expected to be finalized this summer and would authorize more warships, more fighter jets, and more troops. So instead of focusing on what the US government does not agree on, let's concentrate on what everyone's totally okay with every 12 minutes.
I'm gonna go get some more. I'll say something. You people. You're not a race. You are a virus. You destroy the world. Everything beautiful you poison. You drag us from our homes. You rape our daughters, murder our sons. You crack our spines and do all you can to break our will. You stab us. Then you put the knife in our hand and tell us it's our fault. And if you don't do it yourself, you stand by, close your eyes, and pretend there's nothing wrong. And then you pray to your God to silence our screams so that you can enjoy the happiness that we built for you with our blood. But it's not your fault. It's the only way you know how to be. And the only thing that will change anything is if another virus comes along and does to you what you do to us. And I hope that happens very soon.